Figuring out a spring rate for your car can feel like a daunting task, but today we're going to show you just how simple the math behind it really is. Hey, I'm Trevor, and I'm here with Bill today, and today we are going to cover determining a spring rate and actually calculating out a spring rate and the math involved behind it. Now,
this is for a solid axle.
Yes, so today we're gonna be focusing on solid axle suspension in a custom application primarily. So, you know, QA1 offers a number of direct fit coilover setups for various applications. We've already done the work in those kits to determine good spring rates, but today really we're gonna be discussing custom applications and how to best determine a starting spring rate and get that figured out for a car. So at this point in our build example here, we're going to assume that you've got your shock length figured out, you know your spring length you need for that shock. If you've got any questions on that, we've got other videos and information available where you can best determine your shock length and spring length. But today we're going to be going through an example that we know a few inputs, and of those inputs, we're going to say, let's say we've got a 1500 pound rear weight vehicle. So we need to know a few baseline items. And, you know, in addition to spring length, like I mentioned, we need to know vehicle weight, and not specifically just vehicle weight, but hopefully we know the rear weight of the vehicle.
And how much did you say the rear of your cars weigh?
Let's go with 1500 pounds. That's going to be a pretty common, you know, starting point for some custom applications. And that's gonna be my total weight over my rear axle. So rear tires parked on some scales, that is the weight of the back of the car.
So you got 1,500 pounds total here. You have 1,500 pounds total, right? Well, these two springs are only supporting the stuff that's up here. These springs are not holding up the tires and the brakes and the axle, right? So we need to know really more specifically, what's the sprung weight of the vehicle? Now, you can weigh your wheels, tires, brakes, axles, diff fluid. You can weigh all that stuff and come up with a really accurate answer, which is always, the more accurate you can be, the better.
Okay.
But in most of these cases, 250 to 300 pounds is really common for the weight of all of that stuff. So in this example, I'm just gonna assume 300 pounds.
Okay.
So that means our sprung weight is 1200. Sprung, 1200.
So just the weight that's enacting on the springs themselves is just.
Yep,
it's just,
and there are two springs.
Sure.
So there are two springs holding up that 1200 pounds, which means each spring is supporting about, we'll call it 600 pounds.
Yeah.
Okay, so 600 pounds per spring. So what length spring did you say you were gonna be using?
Let's say in this example, we're gonna run a 10 inch spring and we're gonna run those at 30 degrees. Of an angle. So we've got our shocks mounted at a 30 degree angle running that 10 inch spring. The shock angle will be a relatively important factor,
yeah,
as well, and we'll get into that more, but you'll want to have a determination of that too.
Yeah, and we'll run through this as if your springs are vertical, and then I'll show you what happens at that angle.
Perfect.
So we got two springs, two 10 inch springs, and from watching our other videos, you know that we want to start that spring off at about 30% compressed. So 30% of 10 inches is 3 inches.
And when you say 30% compressed, you're talking, we set the weight of the car down on the spring and it compresses 30% of its free length. So
yep.
Yeah, like a 10 inch spring, that's taking up 3 inches of travel just from the weight of the car on the spring.
Yep.
Okay.
So we want that to compress 3 inches. Well, if we take the 600 pounds here that each spring is holding up, and we divide that by the 3 inches that we want it to compress, we wind up with 200 pounds. And what that is 200 pounds per inch.
So that's a 200 pound per inch spring rate now. So we've actually determined a spring rate here.
Yep.
At this point.
So what that means is if you put a 200 pound per inch spring in the back of your car, if it's 1200 pounds of sprung mass, it's gonna compress both of those springs 3 inches.
Got it, okay. That's pretty straightforward.
Pretty straightforward. Now, that 3 inches, that's a really good starting point for a 10 inch spring.
Okay.
It's 30%, which is you know what we recommend starting with, and not even necessarily starting with, that's what a lot of cars wind up with, especially high performance street cars, things where they're pulling double duty, as you know, you're driving, not only are you cruising your kids around and your family, but you're also, maybe you're hitting the autocross at your local, you know, big muscle car event or sure. whatever it is.
So that 30% really is kind of like a do it all, rides nice, performs well, just a good balance as a starting point then.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Perfect.
Yep. So you mentioned though that your spring is going to be at a 30 degree angle.
Yes.
So when you take a spring and you start laying it over, your spring becomes less effective.
Okay.
You can take a physics class or you can take a, you know, a high school science class and figure out why that is. We've got other videos that explain that. But the more you lean that over, the less effective that spring rate becomes. So we've got charts on our website that have what is called an angle correction factor.
Okay.
Which is a number that represents how much spring rate loss you're going to see by tipping that over.
I see.
So if we take our 200 pound spring rate, that's what we came up with. We said, okay, I want to put a 200 pound spring in the back of this car, but if it's going to be at a 30 degree angle, we're going to divide that by our angle correction factor, which in this case is 0.87.
And I'll help you with the math on this one. So we've consulted our angle correction factor sheet. So you're gonna take 200 pounds per inch. We're gonna divide that by 0.87. And that's gonna come out as 229.8.
I think we can call that 230.
I would agree. And what if a 230 spring isn't available too?
But what that's telling you though, is that is the spring rate that you need in order to achieve your 200 pound vertical spring rate.
Sure.
If you took that 200 and multiplied by 0.87, you're gonna see what your effective spring rate is, which is going to be a lower number.
Yep.
Right? So that's saying like, okay, if I put a 230 pound spring back there, it's gonna feel like a 200 pound spring as if the spring were vertical.
I see. Yeah, and like we're seeing here, there's definitely some rounding, you know, that's going on at every assumption factor built along the way. And I don't think in most cases you need to have those, you know, 100% defined. And there can be a little rounding error at play there that's really not going to affect much. Springs are very forgiving in that way, where you can be off on the spring rate to some degree, and it's not going to adversely affect the performance of the car. So don't feel like you have to hit it.
This number is not going to be like a plus or minus 5 pounds. The other thing to remember is that you might come up with a weird number here. This just happened to work out to 230, which is a fairly common number.
Yeah.
But you might come up with like, you know, 263.
Sure.
And you're not going to find a 263 pound per inch spring.
Yep.
But you might be able to find a 250. You might be able to find a 275, both of which are really close to what you came up with. So that change is not going to.
Yeah, and this is a really objective way to solve for a specific spring rate, but we can start adding then some subjectiveness to it. So I think you said like 263 pounds, you're not gonna find that, but if we wanted to handle firmer, maybe we go to a 275, that would be more available, or we drop it down for comfort to a 250 then, so we can start shying one way or the other based on our intended use as well.
Yep. Sometimes it just makes you feel like you're making a better decision if you come up with something in the middle and then you go, okay, well, I want it to feel this way. So you just kind of make a decision in that direction.
Yep.
And then you feel better about it.
That makes perfect sense. So now I'm going to throw another, wild card at you here and say, oh, actually, Bill, I measured my suspension incorrectly. I don't need a 10-inch spring. I actually need a 12-inch spring.
Okay.
What does that do for us here?
If we're gonna, a 12 inch spring, if we're gonna assume that same 30% compressed, 30% of 10 is a different number than 30% of 12.
Right.
So 30% of 12 is 3.6.
Yep.
of 12 equals 3.6. Well, now all I would do here is I would take this 3.6.
Oh, and that goes into here then.
And that just goes right there because that's the number that we were using to determine what the spring rate was. So now that 3.6, what's 600 divided by 3.6?
That gives us 166.6. So we'll call that one.
Ah, interesting. So see how that number now is lower?
Yes.
Basically, we're allowing the 12-inch spring to compress a little bit more. So we can go with a lower rate to get that.
Perfect.
Does
and
that make sense?
That makes perfect sense. And then, yeah, we just feed those new numbers in down the equation.
Yep. So if we did this and we did 166 divided by 0.87.
Call that 190.
190.
I see. So yeah, as we start going with a longer spring, then we can start running a relatively softer spring rate then.
Yep. And that would, a longer spring has more travel
sure.
before it goes solid. So you have more leeway with a longer spring than you do with a shorter spring.
Yeah. Yep. That makes perfect sense. Well, I think you've done a really good job here, Bill, of laying out the math behind calculating a spring rate. And it's quite straightforward, actually, once you've got some known factors in mind here. There's really no magic to it, but yeah, it's just a math equation, and it gets us to an objective starting point. And from there, we'll have to see what we're doing with the car. Of course, if you need any help with this along the way, need any input from us, our techs are always more than happy to walk you through this process on your particular application and check out the other resources that we have available too to help you determine the best spring rate for your build.